the clouds, kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break, his broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? 'Cause our God is a lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb, the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow. Open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. The God who's come to save is here to set the captives free. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power. Stop the Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? There's no one who can stop the Lord Almighty. Yeah. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? There's no one at all who can stop the Lord. Our God is a lion, the Lion.
Tore through the shadows of of my soul. No work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living. Could fathom such boundless grace. The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me. Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living Lord.
That was an awesome time of worship. I love when we can sing to the Lord, we can praise the Lord. And you know, in times like this, we gotta keep our focus on Him, don't we? Now, before we dive into the word, I wanna pray, and especially I wanna pray for those who are sick right now, because we do have some in our congregation who are ill. We wanna ask for God for them especially, that He would touch them, keep them safe through this time that we have never experienced before. So let's pray. Father, we ask that You would encourage and touch and heal those who are sick right now. We ask that You will protect them, that they will get through this illness and come back praising You for Your comfort, Your protection, and encouragement. Lord, I ask protection for those who are listening right now, that You will protect us, that You will give us courage, that You'll take away fear, that we wouldn't live in fear, but we would live in the confidence that You are in control of every single moment of our lives. And we ask also that You would bless the word as we're gonna dive into it, that You will take the Holy Spirit, He will take the pages of this Bible and speak to us, and that we would be changed by it. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody said a great big amen. Amen. Well, I'd like for you to open your Bible to the book of James, the book of James. And we've been looking at what God has to say through James, who was Jesus' half-brother, you could put it that way, I guess. And he was talking about trials. He says in James 1:2, count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let the steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete and lacking in nothing. Now, the outcome of trials is that we may be perfect, complete, and lacking in nothing. Now, James basically says, now, speaking about lacking nothing, and he turns his attention to wisdom. When we're in trials, and when we're looking to God to give us what we need, we realize that we need His wisdom. When I'm going through tough times, when we're experiencing trouble or temptation, we need God's wisdom. How many times have we said, I don't know what to do? I mean, you've said that 100 times in your life. I don't know what to do. You might say in one situation, I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. You may talk to a lot of people trying to get their counsel on something, and you say what? I don't know what to do. So wisdom can be a very tough problem. Gaining wisdom can be a very tough problem. But you know, some kids have got it down, I think. They can be very wise. For instance, Patrick, age 10, said, never trust a dog to watch your food. How's that? Boaz, our dog, the other day, one of the grands had some food sitting on the ground and, I don't know, came over by us, and then we saw him grab it and sneak around a chair and he was eating it. It's like, dog, I mean, but that's part of the nature of a dog. Never trust a dog to watch your food. Michael, 14, said, when your dad is mad and asks you, do I look stupid? Don't answer him. Michael also shared this pearl of wisdom. Never tell your mom her diet's not working. And Eileen, age 8, said, never try to baptize a cat. Most of the time, trouble reveals our need for wisdom, most of the time. Now, I know that we're listening, we might be, you know, we're online or we're listening in some other means, and it's easy just to be passive. What I want you to do is I'd like you to take some notes, okay? Because what we write down, we tend to remember better than just hearing. It goes in one ear and out of the other. So take some notes, because I want you to remember these things, because wisdom is so important in our lives. Most of the time, trouble reveals our need for wisdom. Let's look at James chapter 1, verses 5 through 8. Verses 5 through 8. But if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all men generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith, without any doubting, for the one who doubts is like the surf of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For let not that man expect that he will receive anything from the Lord, being a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. Now it says man, but you understand that it's people. So we could say that man, that woman. Gaining wisdom is one of the most important things in the Christian life. It's one of the most important things in the Christian life. James was a person who had been saturated in the Word of God. And as I read the book of James, one thing that I notice are the parallels to the book of Proverbs. I read a psalm a day, and I read a chapter of Psalms a day and a chapter of Proverbs a day. And having done that, and I'm reading the book of James, I realize the parallels between the two. James was saturated in the wisdom of God's word. He's actually repeating some of the book of Proverbs as you read his letter here. The book of Proverbs is full of counsel concerning wisdom, especially, you guys, how to gain wisdom. How do I get it? It tells us we ought to seek wisdom like we would seek hidden treasure, that we ought to seek wisdom more than we would seek for money. The Bible says that wisdom is one of the most important things that you could ever have. Now, here's something to understand, that in the pagan world, wisdom was understood to be what you know. Okay, the Roman, the Greek, the pagan world, wisdom is what you know. But it wasn't that way to the Hebrew mind. To the Hebrew people, the Jewish people, it was different. The pagans thought, you know, well, someone with a PhD is wiser than someone who has no higher education. That a CEO is wiser than a janitor. That's the way the pagan world would think. And I think that's kind of the way we think a lot of times. Well, if somebody's a doctor, they must be smarter than a mechanic. But the Hebrew concept of wisdom was different. Note this, completely different. To the Hebrew mind, wisdom was the application of what you know to your life. Wisdom was the what? Application of what you know. Their concept, which is biblical, is that doing what you know is wisdom. And as we all know, it's generally easier to know something than it is to do something. I mean, how many of you know how to eat in a healthy way? I mean, everybody knows how to eat in a healthy way. Come on. You all know what not to eat, but how many of us do that, right? We're not wise. We're not wise. We know, but we're not doing. How many of us know that we should exercise? You should exercise. But now a lot of us have become couch potatoes. We're not exercising, though we have the time to do more exercise than we ever have before, right? We're not doing what we know we should do. That's not wise. That's not biblical wisdom. Someone has said, listen, knowledge is the ability to take things apart, while wisdom is the ability to put things together. That's what wisdom is. It's just not knowing, but it's doing. All of us know people who are educated fools, one writer says. They have brilliant academic records, but they still can't make the simplest decisions of life. I know people like that. None, of course, of you, but I do know people like that. They know more than I could possibly know. You know somebody like that? But they can't do the simplest things. Here's a simple, basic definition of wisdom. Write it down. Taking what you know and doing it. We could put it another way, practicing what you know. Knowing what to do and doing what you know. Knowledge is truth, but wisdom is putting the truth into action. I know it's like kind of redundant, but this is what wisdom is. It's doing. Wisdom is the right use of knowledge. So let's go back to James chapter 1 and look at verse 5 again. If we ask the Lord for wisdom, we have the promise that he will give it to us. James chapter 5, verse 1. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given to him. Now, I want to point out a few things that I see in this passage. First thing is that God's promise of wisdom is for all believers. Remember that. God's wisdom is promised for all believers. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all people. You see, this is for everybody, and his help is available to everybody, but I have to say maybe there's one condition, and that is you gotta be a believer. This is not one of those blanket promises. This is only for believers. Any of you, that's believers, lack wisdom. Let him, that's a believer, ask of God who gives to all believers. So that's is contingent upon you believing in Christ. The next thing I want to point out is that God is a giving God. He is a giving God. This could be translated, this is awesome. This is awesome. It could be translated, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask the giving God. Isn't that cool? He is the giving God. We think of God in many ways, but this says he's the giving God. God is our giving God. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he, what? Gave his only begotten son. He's the giving God. And in Titus 2 verse 14, it says, he gave himself for us. There's so many passages that shows us that God is the giving God. He's the one who is generous. He's eager to give. And that is the next thing. God gives generously. It says he gives liberally. God isn't stingy in any way. God wants to bless you. God wants to bless his children. God's not looking for ways not to give. He's eager to give. The passage goes on to tell us that God gives without reproach. What does that mean? I tell you, that's probably the one thing in this passage that I would scratch my head and say, you know, what does this mean? Without reproach. He will give liberally without reproach. Well, the New Living Translation puts it this way. He will not resent your asking. God isn't, you know, in heaven saying, ugh, why are they asking me for wisdom? And he won't give finding fault. He won't give saying, well, you know, you haven't been very good. And now you're asking me for help. Sorry. No, God isn't giving that way. The NIV says he will give without finding fault. You see, God doesn't give to us on the basis of how good we are. God gives to us because he's a God of grace. I can come to God even when I've messed up my life. I mean, that's maybe why you have to ask God for wisdom. Lord, I blew this. What should I do? Again, you're asking God for help. You're asking God for wisdom. And sometimes, you know, gifts can be given in a way that takes away the joy. And God doesn't give gifts that way. Now, this passage continues by giving us the condition for receiving wisdom from God. The condition is, you see it in verse 5, the condition is what? Faith. But let him ask in what? Faith. Faith. But let him ask in faith with no doubting, for the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. So how do we show God we're not doubting? Well, I think it's by persisting in asking for wisdom. God likes and God wants persistent prayer. In Matthew 7, verse 7 and through 9, Jesus said, "Keep on asking and you will receive what you ask for. Keep on seeking and you will find. Keep on knocking, the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and everyone who seeks finds, and to everyone who knocks at the door, it will be opened." God honors persistence in prayer. It doesn't bother him to keep seeking, to keep knocking. He honors that, and he's happy to see that. James tells us that we must ask without any doubting. You know, doubt is the opposite of faith. The doubting person, James says in verse 6, is like the surf of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. The next time you go to the beach, you look at the waves and you realize that those waves that are driven and tossed are like the person who is doubting when they ask for wisdom. Many believers, I think, are like Peter, you know, when he was walking on the water to go to Jesus. He had his eyes on Jesus. He was walking in faith, and then he started doubting what happened to him. He began to sink. And so the Lord says through the Apostle James, ask in faith and don't doubt. That shows that you are really asking in faith, because doubt is the opposite of faith. And the result of unbelief is clear. The Bible says in verse 7, look at verse 7, it says, "For that person must not suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord, because he's a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways." You're not going to get anything from the Lord unless you come to the Lord without doubting. When James was writing this, maybe he was thinking about one of Israel's greatest kings, King Solomon. King Solomon had inherited his father David's kingdom. It was a magnificent kingdom, but he was only 20 years old when he became king. And so wisely, he knew that he needed more wisdom than he had, and so he asked God for wisdom. He was so serious in his pursuit that he sacrificed 1,000 burnt offerings to the Lord. He wanted God's guidance, and he was willing to pay the price for it. Not long after that, God appeared to him in a dream, and God asked him, "What do you want? What do you want?" Actually, in 1 Kings 3, let's go to 1 Kings 3 together. Some of you with your devices beat me to it. We used to have, this is a rabbit trail, but we used to have, when I was in children's ministry and they were teaching you the books of the Bible, they would have what was called a Bible drill. Have you ever heard of that, a Bible drill? And what they did was they'd say a verse and you'd have to find the verse in your Bible, and you know, it would be tough for some, not for me. I won the drill several times. But here in 1 Kings chapter 3, God, after seeing David's sincere request for wisdom, God answers him. In a dream, God says, look at chapter 3, verse 5. He says, "Ask for whatever you want me to give you." That's awesome, isn't it? God says, "Ask me, Solomon, what do you want? I'll give it to you." What would you have asked for? Maybe you would have asked for health, maybe for wealth, maybe for a long life, maybe to be some kind of a celebrity. But Solomon didn't ask for any of those things. God said, "What do you want? Anything, I'll give it to you." Instead of asking for those kinds of things, he asked for something that most people wouldn't have even thought about. And it really showed his heart. Look at what he said in 1 Kings chapter 3, verses 7 through 9. "And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of David my father, although I am but a little child. I don't know how to go out or come in. Your servant is in the midst of your people whom you've chosen, a great people, too many to be numbered or counted for multitude." Verse 9. "Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind." Right there, that's Solomon asking for wisdom. "Give your servant, an understanding mind to govern your people that I may discern between good and evil, for who is able to govern this great people? I need help, God. I don't know what to do. I need your help. Solomon asked for the greatest thing he could have ever asked for. He asked God for wisdom. And the Lord was pleased that Solomon had asked for wisdom. Read on, verses 11 through 14. Verses 11 through 14. And God said to him, because you have asked this and have not asked yourself for long life or riches or the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, behold, I now do according to your word. Behold, I give you a wise and discerning mind, so that none like you has ever been before you, and none like you shall arise after you. I give you also what you have not asked, both riches and honor, so that no other king shall compare with you all your days. And if you will walk in my ways, keep in my statutes and my commandments as your father David walked, then I will lengthen your days. He asked for wisdom, not all those other things. And God says, and you asked for wisdom. You know what? I'm gonna bless you with the things you didn't ask for. Now, at some point after this, Solomon was faced with an extremely difficult problem. Look at 1 Kings chapter 3, verses 16 through 22. Then two women who were harlots came to the king and stood before him. The one woman said, oh my Lord, this woman and I live in the same house, and I gave birth to a child while she was in the house. Then on the third day after I gave birth, the woman also gave birth, and we were alone. There was no one else with us in the house, only we two were in the house. And this woman's son died in the night because she laid on him. And she arose at midnight and she took my son from beside me while your servant slept and laid him at her breast and laid her dead son at my breast. When I rose in the morning to nurse my child, behold, he was dead. But when I looked at him closely in the morning, behold, he was not my child that I had born. But the other woman said, no, the living child is mine and the dead child is yours. The first said, no, the child, that child is yours and the living child is mine. Thus they spoke before the king. Ah, how are you gonna figure that one out? How do you know? Well, making a right judgment today would be really easy. What would you have done? Well, you'd do a DNA test, but you don't have a DNA test then. So how are you gonna figure this out? Well, we already know that God had given Solomon super mega wisdom, don't we? He had asked for that. God says, I give you wisdom. And we see it demonstrated now in his response to these two women. Look at verses 23 through 28. Then the king said, the one says, this is my son that is alive and your son is dead. And the other says, no, but your son is dead and my son is a living one. And the king said, bring me a sword. So a sword was brought before the king. And the king said, divide the living child in two and give half to one and half to the other. Then the woman whose son was alive said to the king, because her heart yearned for her son, oh my Lord, give her the living child and by no means put him to death. But the other said, he shall be neither mine nor yours, divide him. Then the king answered and said, give the living child to the first woman, by no means put him to death. For she is his mother. And all Israel heard of the judgment that the king had rendered, and they stood in awe of the king because they perceived that the wisdom of God was in him to do justice. Would you have ever have thought of that? Never would I have thought of that. How wise to figure, oh, the real mother is gonna say, don't hurt my child, you can do anything with my child, just don't let my child die. Solomon had the wisdom to be able to discern between right and wrong, and truth and error, and honesty from deceit, love versus selfishness. And wisdom, God's wisdom, can be given to you so that you can discern what is right and what is wrong, truth from error, honesty from deceit, and love versus selfishness. That's practical wisdom. God gave Solomon the greatest gift that a person could ever have. He gave him the ability to take knowledge, what he knew, and put it into practice. Now, a lot of believers, a lot of you, have a lot of wisdom when it comes to knowing the Word of God, knowing what's right, knowing what's wrong. But the challenge is putting what you know into practice, doing what you know. You know, the Spirit of God is the one who gave Solomon the kind of wisdom that he had, and the Spirit of God will give us that same kind of wisdom. We're living in the new covenant. We're living in a time when God isn't simply reserving wisdom for a certain few. We're living in the new covenant where God says, if any of you lack wisdom, ask of God and he will give you the wisdom that you need. Keep asking God. I don't know what to do. Keep asking God. How will he give you that wisdom? Well, sometimes it will be people who speak into your life. Go to right people. Don't go to the people who have failed in what you're asking wisdom for. Go to people who are righteous people that you see walking out the truth. So you may receive wisdom. God gives you wisdom through godly people. God will give you wisdom through his word. You'll be reading in his word and something just jumps out of you, and out at you rather, and you realize that's God's message for me. God may give you wisdom by having you wait and circumstances change. And you realize, oh, that's what I should do. I'm glad I waited. You're not running ahead of God. But God will give you wisdom. He promised that wisdom, and God is a promise keeper, right? Every single word of God is true. Wisdom pleases God. God is pleased to give you his wisdom if you will simply ask. So let's do that right now. Father in heaven, we thank you that you have promised to give us wisdom when we ask you. And there are a lot of us who don't know what to do right now. We're not in control of our situation. We're not in control of our lives. We're not in control of our finances, our health. We're not in control of so many things. And we need your help to know what to do. And we thank you that in your word, you have a promise that you will give us the wisdom that we need to do what is right, to do what is so necessary for us to do. We're grateful for your word. In Jesus' name, and everybody wherever you are said, amen. Hey. You know, one of the things that is so important for us to do is continue to keep God in the very forefront of our lives. I want to thank you guys for the way that you've been doing that in supporting God's work here for our church. You know, even though we're not gathering all together, we're still the church. The church hasn't stopped. The outreaches of the church continue, and you are supporting God's work. Some of you have just upped your giving. You're saying, I'm going to give because I have faith that right now in a difficult time, the Lord's going to do more, maybe than he's ever done before. I know we're reaching more people than we ever have before. And so thank you for supporting your church, for giving to God's work. And I believe God's going to bless you for that because his word promises that. Now, before we tune out here, what I want to do is I want to ask God's blessing on you. So wherever you are, would you just bow your heads? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. and may the Lord lift up his countenance on you. That means smile on you and give you his peace and his special protection. It's my prayer for you in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.